Excited to have Rich Hopenhouse, the BC-based singer, songwriter, electric guitarist, and front runner of many bands, including Rich Hope and his Evil Doers, an electric country, blues, and rockabilly style group. I hope you're okay with me saying that. It's definitely a combination of many genres. And they're set to appear at the TD Vancouver International Jazz Festival in Canada Day, July 1st at 8 p.m. at the Granville Island Railspur District stage. So you can catch them there at 8 p.m. It'll be such a party. I'm really excited for that because it's an outdoor venue. It's Canada Day. There's going to be that, already going to be that sense of energy and excitement. And to have this really fun band ending the night, capping it off, will be great. So thanks so much for being here, Rich. We're really excited to chat and to get all the down low on what you're doing right now and what you're prepping for your jazz festival performance. Mm-hmm. Rich Hope's no-nonsense, straight-up and honest style infiltrates into every aspect of his professional sound, be it within one of the tracks on any of his five released records or during one of his crowd-rousing live performances. Throughout his 20-year career, Rich Hope has established himself as a strong solo blues and country artist, as well as the headliner of multiple musical arrangements, including Rich Hope and his Evil Doers, as well as his country music band, the Blue Rich Hope Rangers. At one of Rich Hope's shows, he creates music that is both audacious and bold, as well as heartfelt and moving for his fans, at least I felt by listening to your music. I have never heard you live, but that's the feeling I had. Hope's many North American tours and performances have gathered him huge popularity throughout many pockets of the continent, and his homegrown sound has proven to be hugely approachable as well as relatable for Canadians countrywide. Hope's album, Rich Hope and His Evil Doers, was nominated for Best Blues Album at the Western Canadian Music Awards, and just this past year in 2016, he released his latest album, Can't Get No Lovin', which is sure to gain similar recognition, I'm certain. So
we're waiting for it.
We're really excited to have you here and to have you join us this summer for what's sure to be a really fun party, like I've already said, at the Jazz Festival. It's going to be really fun. We're going to pray for good weather so we can just enjoy the day and the sunset, which will be around that time.
Hope so.
So, yeah. First off, you've had such a great career. I'm sure it's taken you to, and are continuing to. You have gone to many places with your music, many tours, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. But throughout it all, it sounds like you've really stayed true to your sound and to your genre and like this character of music that you embody. Mm-hmm. So what initially drew you to that? What drew you to country and blues? Was it a certain person, a certain musician?
Yeah.
Or is it just something you found kind of growing up?
I just found it. And I wouldn't even put blues in that category because I didn't find the right blues till I was much older. I think when I was growing up in the, in the 70s and 80s, and what I heard of blues then was not even anything close to what I would appreciate now. Yeah. But my biggest influences were probably like Willie Nelson and Waylon Jennings, which I thought that was country.
Right.
But I was sort of simultaneously conscious of the fact that that wasn't, two-stepping country so mm-hmm. much, and that these guys had long hair and that cowboys and bikers who would normally be kicking the crap out of each other would be at their shows together. Mm-hmm. And so I think like that left the most indelible stamp on me, was just that what those guys did was play music.
Right.
And later on I discovered The Clash, and that was like the first rock and roll mm-hmm. band I really ever really dug, you know.
Yeah.
And then it went on through like the Stones and all that stuff. Mm-hmm. And I discovered, you know, I remember really loving Stevie Ray Vaughan when I was young. Mm-hmm. But I never was able to like play like that. And I don't know, when I discovered blues artists like Junior Kimbrough and R.L. Burnside and John Lee Hooker and all that stuff, I discovered that whole other side of blues that was this one chord kind of trance blues and this boogie thing that where these guys would just play, you know, a thing over and over again and just sing and stomp
like
their
vamping,
foot.
Kind of.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there were no chord changes. There was no real, like, there was no playing.
Yeah.
Nobody was buying effects pedals and fancy pickups for guitars. It was like
it was
the
really
shittiest
real.
Guitar you could have. If they could afford one at all. And that, I just sort of, that speaks to me way more.
I think so too.
You know? And so I think that kind of stuff informs me. And like I say, the country's always been there. Whether we're playing more rock and roll stuff or more country, it's always kind of in there.
Yeah.
Again, just because of the country that I liked. It just always had a bit of rock and roll in it, you know?
Yeah. We are definitely a reflection of the music we like and the sounds we like.
Yeah.
And I think, especially your comment about not really understanding or feeling the blues portion when you first started.
Yeah.
I think that's quite normal, because as you evolve, that's what the genre means more, right? Like, it's a little bit more reflective and whatnot. So, I think that your latest album, that sound is filled with all those different styles that you were mentioning.
Yeah.
And Can't Get No Lovin' is what it's called.
Yeah.
But I think that every track almost embodies a specific kind of sound, and what I loved is that a lot of them were ballad, almost ballad
yeah
formats.
There's a couple that are kind of like that.
Yeah The Ballad of Black Eyed Susie and Annette Your Time Has Come but instead of it just being kind of like you leading the vocals and the storyline, you still have chances to really like let it tear up on guitar. So tell me a little bit about that. How do you write these songs, and how do you still like incorporate your storytelling element but also the chance to feature your musicianship and your guitar playing?
Again, it's just that's how I grew up. That's the format I grew up in. People played rock songs, and you can talk about things in them, you know. I love really dumb rock songs, and I love songs that have a story in them too. That EP actually came out of the whole Blue Ridge Rangers project.
Okay.
So we were like, oh, we should do some stuff and we should write some things, because we were playing all these country covers every month, and like people would come to the show and just have beers and listen to us play Buck Owens. And Scott Smith and I, we were like, let's start writing some stuff. And like Annette was an email he sent to me with a riff. He's like, I got this thing, and I'm, all of a sudden I'm like, oh my god, we gotta this is a great riff. So as for the songwriting question, it was really one of the first times in a while that I haven't just written it on my own. Just probably due to life circumstances. I've always been kind of a day writer.
Okay.
And I have a day job now. So I don't get as much time to do that, so I thought, well, I'll just rely on my friends and let's trade ideas back and forth. There's tons of songwriters do. And I hadn't done that in about 10 years.
In 10 years.
So that song came out of that, and Can't Get No Lovin' came out of that. And all of those songs did. And the last two are covers. We did a George Jones song and a Sir Douglas Quintet song. But yeah, I think that whole showmanship aspect comes when you want to have some guitar parts in there, you know.
Yeah,
I still
so
love a guitar
fun.
Solo.
Well, that's kind of like where you've always been your whole career as a musician.
Oh, yeah.
Like you are a guitarist, and that's like that's the moment on stage, I think, like just by listening to your music, that is like featuring you, but it's fun. It's like you're not doing it to like show off. It's just like, this is
I love this.
I
can't.
No.
I'm not very good at it. Like I'm really not much of a guitar player. I can I think I have a sound and I got a right hand, but you know, so did Bo Diddley. Like, if I could be as bold as compared to that, it always spoke to me more. Again, I'll go back to Willie Nelson. Willie Nelson doesn't do a whole lot of showing off. It's the way, excuse me, it was the way he picked a note and the moment he picked a note. Waylon Jennings, same way. Pretty good guitar player. They got kind of one or two things that they do really well, and it leaves an impression on you.
But I think that's what being a good musician is. It's not necessarily the technique that you've learned and developed over your life. I mean, that's a part of it, of course, but it comes down to the feeling and the musicianship, and then like knowing when to place that, knowing when the moment is right, especially when you're collaborating with a whole bunch of other players. That's another combo that, okay, maybe like this person won't vibe on that, so I need to pick the right moment when they're listening to me. And that's part of being a good player.
That's
the technique.
Idea is absolutely showcased on Black Eyed Susie, mm-hmm. because that is Scott and I trading mm-hmm. guitar parts.
Oh, is it? I couldn't.
It's a funny story because we're in the studio and Scott put all of his country licks down, and mm-hmm. Scott is just a wonderful guitar player, so he's doing all this stuff, and I have to go back and do all the responses.
Yeah,
and I'm sitting here trying to do what he does.
Yeah,
I keep screwing it up, and I keep getting mad. And Eric Nielsen comes through the mic. He's like, "Rich," or no. When I got really mad, I would just hit it and do this thing, and I'd hear this, "Yeah, that was great." And I'm like, "What are you talking about? That was terrible.
Well,
I was trying to do this thing." And Eric's mm-hmm. going, no, that's what you do. So quit trying to do what Scott does. And I just laughed and said, okay, yeah, I'll just do what I do.
And then
because of that, you know, you can lose yourself because you want to be as good as my pal. But yeah.
I think it's a bit of like a double-edged sword. Like, you want to be constantly challenged by your collaborators.
Yes.
And have them kind of like encourage you to raise the bar all the time.
Yeah.
But we don't want to be challenged to the point of replicating that or feeling like you need to be that.
Yeah,
same
absolutely.
Style.
And you know, I think it was just a funny reminder of just mm-hmm. what you respect in other people is, you know, maybe the opposite of what they respect in you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like and guitar playing can be just as good as a sound. Like mm-hmm. I love Hound Dog Taylor. Hound Dog Taylor just makes a sound. He played slide, and he doesn't go all over the fretboard. It just sounds gross and great, and he'd play all night.
And I think that's what audiences always are able to tell.
Yeah.
When the musicians on stage are enjoying their sound and, mm-hmm. and really, like, making an effort to play that beautiful sound that drew them to the stage in the first place. Like, it's so evident from an audience point of view. Like,
absolutely.
It's not like I don't know how you feel playing your own music versus... Yeah. Playing covers, of course, you can still enjoy playing covers and enjoy the sound of that
because
it's the greats who wrote them. But I'm wondering if when you play your own music, if you have that sense of kind of like drive to make it, be a little bit more about the music. I don't know. That's a nice question for you.
Yeah, I think you do every time mm-hmm. you play a song, mm-hmm. and if you don't really feel that, you probably should leave that one out of the set. I think it just should not go in.
Okay, very true.
Because then it's not fun anymore.
No.
Yeah. No, it's a pertinent question. It just you never want to just run through stuff, I think.
No. So for the jazz festival performance on Canada Day, are you bringing a set? Do you know your set yet? Are you bringing music that's going to be a combo of covers and your own music?
It's
or?
All mine. There
okay,
might
great.
Be one, and it's all. Most of it is really new.
New.
Like, it's the record I've been working on now for the last year or so. Oh, yeah, it's
good. Yeah. We're excited.
Yeah.
So it's not necessarily...
All that stuff we just talked about probably won't be in the set list.
Okay,
it just isn't.
But a lot of your kind of, like, go-to music that you've been playing for a while from your old albums,
mm-hmm.
people can expect to hear, too?
Yeah, there's always, there's always, I always lean a lot on the stuff from Rich Hope is going to With It On You, because people really know that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, it's not a long set, so you always have to leave things out. But I really am loving playing the new stuff, so I just feel like mm-hmm. doing that, you know what I mean?
Any tracks specifically for us to look out for?
Well, you know, we always end up doing When My Light Comes Shining, because mm-hmm. people like to sing that one. And I don't know. Other than that, I'm not sure yet. I keep it pretty.
No worries.
Keep it pretty undercover.
And I think
the
that's a good thing.
Just in case I change my mind.
It's always nice to be surprised.
Oh.
When I was listening to your EP, Can't Get No Loving.
Yeah.
I loved the one Shoulder to Shoulder. Is that a cover? Or is that
that's a George Jones song.
It's a George Jones.
It's really not a very well
known
George
world.
Jones song.
Really,
that's okay. Even if you look it up, it's hard to find because he had a couple songs called Shoulder to Shoulder,
mm-hmm.
or at least he did too. They're probably written by other people. I don't know. We just decided to do that one because we liked playing it.
I liked it, for those of you listening, because the metaphor in it is this woman's lies are as long as the tracks of a railroad, and they keep winding and winding. And it's also a really fun track because when I was listening to it, I was thinking it would be a good one to do some line dancing to.
Oh, absolutely.
It's that
right?
exact beat.
Yeah.
And I just learned how to line dance really recently at the
did
Yale
you?
Saloon.
Oh, no,
I had lessons. And so I will be out there dancing, line dancing, if anyone wants to join me. If you do that.
I'll just, you can line dance to anything else.
Exactly. Okay. Well,
it'll be okay.
We'll try. If it happens, it happens. And I guess we've been chatting a lot about the Jazz Fest and about what you've been doing. Any plans personally that you have in addition to juggling your day job and writing music and this new album?
Yeah.
What do you have coming up in your future beyond the Jazz Festival? If you have anything set in stone to share.
In the not so distant future.
Yeah.
Well, the only thing I have set in stone, still not set in stone, but is I want to finish this record off and release it. It's just not sure, I'm not sure what outlet that will be yet, you know?
Yeah.
And we'll do a couple more shows in the summer here and there. But I'd really like to just, that's my main goal, is just finish that thing off. It's taken a while, only because, again, everybody's on tour and busy and things just, I've really let it be very organic, this record.
That's
we've only recorded
way.
When we felt like it.
That's the best way.
It just has to be right now.
Yeah.
I don't have 2.5 weeks or 3 weeks to go in a studio and bang something out, you know. I'd rather.
And even that, like, in the grand scheme of things, it's like, that's a short amount of time.
That's
like,
a very short amount
of
time.
You can't force your brain to just come up with music. I think it has to be organic, and the inspiration comes from so many places.
Yeah, I find I don't have that ability. It just, it comes when it comes. Actually, if you took all the sessions we did and you squished them together, it'd be about 2 weeks. So it was just a long time between each one.
Yeah.
But it was a good group of musicians that were floating in and out of town, and when they were all in town, we'd be like, hey, let's do this.
Yeah.
And we'd go and get great things. Sometimes things we hadn't even written, we just wrote them right in the studio. So it was a fun, that was what I wanted to do with this record. So hopefully it will kind of sound like that's what happened too.
Yeah.
It's pretty fun.
Well, it's really exciting. We're so looking forward to your show.
Yeah, me too.
One last note. When I was doing my research on Rich Hope, I learned that one of his shows at the Railway Club was a legendary night where it was the busiest in history
a while ago.
And so if that night is any preview of what's to come at the festival, it'll be so much fun, like lots of dancing, lots of energy. And you guys really know how to rally a crowd. So we're really looking forward to hearing Rich Hope and his Evil Doers on July 1st, 8 p.m. on Canada Day in Granville Island at the Railspur District Stage. So look for the maps to find that, the Railspur District Stage. Thanks so much, Rich, for coming here.
Thanks for having me.
And we're really looking forward to that.
Pleasure.
Take care.
I had a troubled life.